So Pampanga, Megalopolis, and drug dealing problems. Yeah, some global best practices with the viral food. This is the High Line in New York. It's an abandoned railway, and the New York government wanted to demolish it. The New Yorkers wanted to just maintain it as an elevated walkway, interconnecting the various skyscrapers. Next slide. And Singapore, 45% green open space, intelligent city infrastructure, interconnected buildings, like the buildings are being interconnected, so that if one building is on fire, it always goes to the next building. And Bali, Indonesia, sustainable tourism plan. Hawaii, sustainable tourism plan. Parks and open spaces are the lungs of the cities. We're losing them now in Metro Manila. And the frontage of parks and open spaces, higher land values. And Vancouver, Canada, best green building policy, 200 parks. Vancouver again, forest in the city. And Toronto, urban forest program. Stockholm, revival of rivers, and they orient the buildings to the riverfront, waterfront. Bogota, public transit. The mayor said, poor mayor said that the education first world country, the leaders in industry and government take the public transit to walk to work. Curitiba, Brazil. You can see that even the bus stop is the same level as the floor of the bus. It's one of the better bus transit systems in the world. And bicycle, Copenhagen, even the prime ministers, they bicycle to work. And bicycle skyways in China. Bicycle bridge in Copenhagen. Germany, car-free city. The Germans make the best cars in the world, but they don't even allow their cars downtown. Portland, Oregon, 200 miles of bicycle lanes, trails, and pathways. Barcelona, Spain, walkable community. This is the last Ramblas. You only have half a day to go to see Barcelona. You can walk from the downtown up to the waterfront. You can see the variety of cultures, cuisine, architecture, interfaith, and so on. And Bosco, Verticale, and Milan. I met the article just 3 times already. 20,000 trees planted in a skyscraper. Copenhagen, Denmark, they're just like garbage, waste to energy, architectural design. Hiroshima, Japan, the worst devastated city during the war. I met the mayor, and this is what it is today. So it can be done. Warsaw, Poland, the third worst devastated city. And this is Warsaw, Poland today. These are the top 10 cities in the world. Like I wanted really to see here, see this one. Green, Copenhagen, Amsterdam, Stockholm, Vancouver, Curitiba, Brazil, Reykjavik, London, San Francisco, Helsinki, and Austin. Smart cities, New York, number one now. London, Paris, Boston, San Francisco, Washington, D.C., Seoul, Korea, and Tokyo, and Berlin, and Amsterdam. Urban mobility, number one is Hong Kong, Zurich, Paris, Seoul, Prague, Vienna, London, Singapore, Stockholm, Frankfurt. Resilient, number one is Toronto, Vancouver, Calgary, all from Canada. Chicago, Pittsburgh, Stockholm, Boston, Zurich, Washington, D.C., and Atlanta. Livable cities, Melbourne, Vienna, Vancouver, Toronto, Calgary, Adelaide, Perth, Auckland, Helsinki, and Hamburg. Tourist cities, number one is Bangkok, and then London, Paris, Dubai, Singapore, Tokyo, Seoul, New York, Kuala Lumpur, and Hong Kong. Livable cities, Melbourne, Vienna, Vancouver, Toronto, Calgary, Adelaide, Perth, Auckland, Helsinki, and Hamburg. Gateway cities, Dubai, number one now, London, Hong Kong, Paris, Amsterdam, Singapore, Frankfurt, ancient Korea, Bangkok, and Istanbul. Innovative nations, number one now is South Korea. And Sweden, Singapore, Germany, Switzerland, Japan, Finland, Denmark, France, and Israel. I think reason for that, they really have a big budget for R&D. The safest city, number one, Tokyo, Singapore, Osaka, Toronto, Melbourne, Amsterdam, Sydney, Stockholm, Hong Kong, and so on. Why am I showing you this? We're still using the role models here, Los Angeles. We've got three mayors of Los Angeles, and they were announcing to the rest of the world It's a 70-year-old estate. Because Los Angeles was designed for the automobile. After your talk, I tell them, congratulations, thank you, Mayor, admitting your mistakes. I have a big problem in my country. They said, where are you from? The Philippines. What's wrong? And I told them, we commit all your mistakes. And our leaders of industry and government are not aware of it. And they found their way into our building code, zoning code, deed restrictions. I see advertisements of real estate companies just like living in Los Angeles. So Dubai, something close to my heart. 1975-76, I was still there for the World Bank funded Metro Plan Manila. It was one of the best metro plans in the world. But the rulers of Dubai invited me to help plan Dubai from the desert into a garden city. Went to the first world in 15 years. Beside Dubai, as if there's no oil. Overtake the love cities ahead of Dubai, like Kuwait was 15 years ahead, and so on. And what I liked so much was every year of service with your family, go around the world and copy. That's Marty. Bring it back to Dubai. So this was Dubai 1960. That's the peak that was still good. The Dubai settlements. And not a single kilometer. And the same creek is today. It was dredged to be navigable. And because of the visionary leadership of the rulers of Dubai. And this was Dubai 1977, the clock tower. Dubai today, the tallest building in the world, 828 meters high. Next slide. Dubai waterfront before. Dubai waterfront today. Dubai Airport 1970. Dubai Airport today. This is 90 million passengers a day. And they're building the largest airport in the world, additional 220 million passengers. And the population of Dubai is only 4 million. That's when I say the targets here, 20 million tourists, compared to Dubai, so minuscule. And yet we helped Dubai, many of us, although I was the first association architect there. And Dubai Port, they had to import gardens from Pakistan, irrigation from Germany, flowers from Holland, just to bring the city. The Palm Islands, they ran out of waterfront real estate, only 70 kilometers. So Sheikh Mohammed decided to do the Palm Islands, just to add 2,000 kilometers more of artificial waterfront. Next slide. So this is artificial lake, the Burj Al Arab, the first seven-star hotel in the world. And Dubai Mall, the largest mall in the world. There are six kinds of infrastructure. And what we're doing now, the hard infrastructure, the build. Progressive infrastructure are the international seaports, international airports, international schools, international standard hotels, hospitals, what have you. Hard infrastructure, these are the roads and utilities. These are the build. We're doing that. Soft infrastructure is probably the most important. The ease of doing business, no red tape, no corruption. Then green and sustainable, we can discuss that. Digital infrastructure, and the millennials are the natives of this digital infrastructure. Maybe movers like me are the aliens. Then institutional infrastructure. We may have the best plans in the world, but if you don't have the institutions to implement them, nothing happens. Just like Metro Plan Manila. And we have this, we came up with this integration of ecology. People first or equity, then we can talk about planet, earth, and environment, then profit, economy, then history, culture, and heritage, and interfaith, spirituality. So every project we do this guides us. The people first include people now and future generations. And these are our lead sustainable development advocacies, green architecture, urbanism, technology, energy, interiors, furniture, infrastructure, manufacturing, green transportation, green purchasing, green jobs, hopefully green sustainable development. And we should have smarter cities. And this is how we define it. Hopefully we have smarter people to describe the cities. Smart growth approach. The American Planning Association, the American Institute of Architects have been very active. The Americans told me, because I asked them, why smart growth? And they said, they have been doing dumb growth, the mistakes in planning. That's why smart growth. and these are mixing land uses, taking advantage of compact building designs, creating a range of housing opportunities and choices, creating walkable neighborhoods, foster distinctive communities with strong sense of place, and smart growth approach, preserving open space, farmland, natural beauty, critical environment areas, strengthening direct development towards existing communities, providing variety of transport choices, make development decisions predictable, fair, and cost-effective, encouraging communities and stakeholders' collaboration in development decisions, and growth smart, greater community, and so on. Next slide. Green urbanism. It's really what we showed you. Integrating places to live, workshop, and dine, worship, reduce the carbon footprint. And instead of urban sprawl, that's what we have here. We should have more compact development, segregated, more integrated, congested, better connected. And Hong Kong, 71% open space. If the rest of the world, we use the density of Hong Kong, all the world's 7 billion population, we can all fit in the state of Texas. So for me, it's not population control, it's more population distribution. And again, Singapore, Asia's biggest city, and San Francisco, by Phoenix City, a city infused with an abundance of nature. And Washington is the world's first lead platinum city. 65% neighborhoods are walkable, 58% commute to work. And green and sustainable architecture. Next slide. And there's the United Nations definition, meeting the needs of present generations without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their needs. For me, the best definition is from the Native American Indian Chief Seattle. We do not inherit the earth. We don't inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. Zero net energy, 2030 challenge. I signed up at this 15 years ago, that by 2030, the buildings we design and communities we plan must be carbon neutral. But people were surprised when I returned $1 million architects from Subic, which were instructed to design a six-star hotel that destroyed 366 70-year-old trees. And one of the reasons is this. But on the upside, when we designed Manila Palafox, I asked for 2 million pesos more to preserve the 250-year-old trees. Which for me, a 50-year-old tree, the replacement value is 9 million pesos for the oxygen of 50 years, the rainwater it harvested, the fertilizer it planted earth, and the cooling effect, and the beauty it gives the environment. One of my professors at the Harvard Graduate School of Design used to tell us, this century will be a rare century. We imagine, we plan, we architecture, we design, we engineer, we develop, renew, reduce, reuse, recycle, and hopefully we'll have urban renaissance. And what gets measured gets money. Sustainable design and mitigation. Next slide. And this was our first concept for the Global Gateway. And the Emir of Kuwait committed $1 billion and that would have created 72,000 jobs. And this one we won the first, second, third prize for the future DVP in Fort Bonifacio. It's cross-ventilated, natural lighting, rainwater harvesting, and so on. And this one we, Landmark Cebu, we also won the international design competition. The Asian Development Bank, latest building, also won the design competition. It's certified. This is a museum supposed to be built. And I requested that all the 50-year-old trees must be preserved, including the trees that will be inside the museum. And we designed six buildings that came out of the financial district in Saudi Arabia. All the buildings must be green, interconnected, sustainable. You can see green walls, solar walls, green roof, interconnected buildings with skywalks and monorail. And the street level, only for pedestrians and beautiful cars. If your car is ugly, you go to the basement. You can see the interconnections. Next slide. We proposed this for Smoky Mountain with green roof and green walls. adaptive architecture. So the ground floor gets flooded every night. When there are no floods, it's a playground for children. And we encourage them to plant vegetables. And next slide. Also, green architecture for urban poor. We as an expert gave us what kind of plants, like eggplant, ampalaya, and so on. I had to do it because one time I said, plant high value crops. They planted marijuana. They plant the blame for them. Excuse developments. These are our, the first 5 hours of ground work are the architects and mixed use. This is the future of urban living. You live upstairs, the yellow portion, work in the middle, shop and dine on the ground floor. So vertical transportation. This was one of my first guesses for Rockwell on the right side. It's just in Rockwell today, very similar. There's a few changes. This is the 5 towers that we designed. What they taught us in architectural schools is that there are 4 kinds of facade. The front facade, back facade, right side, left side. For me, more importantly, is the facade from above. How the buildings connect with the open spaces. And next slide. And this is the ground space you see from above. Connectivity, convergence, visual corridors. And develop affordable mixed-use neighborhoods. And again, so for Clark Master Plan, what we put forward is that every 400 meters, there's a park and convenience daily for daily meeting. We're done. I just go very fast. This one I'll show you. It had a skyway and a road above the canal, and they remove them and put it back into a people place. Millennium Park was mentioned a while ago. Transportation. The 20 kinds of urban transport. Those with less inputs at that point. 1/3 of the road space must be for trees and landscaping. 1/3 for bicycles and pedestrians. And 1/3 only for the moving traffic lane. We have a lot more. What we've been doing is we take pictures of the amplification of our cities. We do architectural perspectives and we send it to the mayors. And some of them have hired us for urban renewal. Some of them are very upset with us. So, Pampanga, Megalopolis. This one, I'd like to show for our countries. If you rotate the map of the world, we're in the middle. So it's not surprising that when Jen and I arrived here in Latin America, for more than 300 years, where the Asia Pacific Hub is based. 50 years the Americans, 4 years the Japanese, 2 years the British. And so every superpower country is interested in their islands. We're number one in the world in marine biodiversity. We're number one now in sailors. We're number one in call centers. We're number two in geothermal energy. I don't know why, it's expensive. Number two now in BPOs. The third longest coastline in the world. Dubai had to build artificial coastline, selling it enough. And we have the third longest coastline in the world. Unfortunately, we have a Philippine Coast Guard, all coast, no guards. We have a Philippine Air Force, all air, no force. We'll never be able to protect. Yeah. So I think there's enough time to present all of this. We'll have another forum to share with you the best practices in the world that we're trying to implement for all our plans. And we're not just doing Pampanga, Clark. We also won the Cyber Division of Metro Davao, Siargao, Boracay, not the rehab, the tourism master plan for the princess. And good news, zero corruption. Despite the rhetorics of the president, I think change has come. Thank you very much.